So we should, okay. First announcement, of course, we're recording everything, so it will be available later on YouTube and different platforms. So hello, everyone. My name is Marcin Nowacki. Together with me, of course, today, Karolina Milczarek from R&D department. More than happy to welcome you on another webinar from VIGO. Today it will be very interesting topics. We decided to have a little deeper dive in what's in front of us. Previously we were always discussing our capabilities of what we can do for now. Currently we want to show you a little bit more how we develop our products and show you something something new and exciting for the next couple of months, which will be developed, and I think this year will be finished as available products. So of course Karolina is a detector development engineer here at VIGO. We'll be presenting our new dedicated modules for NDIR gas sensors. So we decided to show you a pretty basic step for this range of products which we will develop. So it will cover a lot of applications and lots of different types of substances, gases, and I hope everybody will see how wide we can approach to this application with this new approach. So of course, don't hesitate to ask questions during the presentation using chat or email us afterwards. So this is first topic of first presentation, pretty exciting. After that, let me introduce Filip Wabai, our optoelectronic system engineer from R&D department too. Filip will present what's going on in VIGO in regards to mid-infrared spectroscopy. A lot of you were asking us about are we changing the market, but no, we're not changing. We're just conquering yet another field of the market. So we want to introduce you to our results for our own spectroscope. And Filip will show you a lot of interesting stuff. So it will be pretty intense presentation with a lot of details, a lot of overview of how we approach the new problematic, how we try to use our new endeavors and what we learned for a couple last years. So please, we'll try to make a short break before Filip's presentation so everybody can have a clean sheet of paper and refill the pen to take notes, because it will be pretty detailed presentation. So don't hesitate to go over time with us with questions. After the presentation, we will gladly answer every question posted. So yeah, let's wait a couple of minutes for the late guys. I see people still joining. So one thing I wanted to tell you is that we want to underline that VIGO presented the new strategy a couple of weeks ago, and I encourage you to have a look on of how we think about VIGO in the next 5 years or even beyond that. A lot of ambitious projects were prepared and acknowledged. So I hope everybody will find something interesting in our new strategy, which in comparison to the previous strategy, we are more focusing on development than expanding the VIGO infrastructures. So it will be more information on how we can cooperate on bigger projects. So it will focus us more on developing the market, developing the current customers, developing the new products, the new possible applications. So I hope it will be pretty exciting lectures for everybody who didn't read it already. So we'll send the link in the summary of the webinar. Of course, as usual, please visit us on LinkedIn. We have everything there posted before any place else. And yeah, I think enough from me. Let's get to the interesting stuff. Carolina, voice is yours.
Thank you very much. So let me share the presentation with you. Okay, so as my colleague said, my name is Karolina Milczarek. I'm very happy to see you all at this presentation, and I'm going to talk about NDIR gas sensors dedicated modules. So at the very beginning of my presentation, I'm going to briefly introduce you to NDIR type gas sensing. It's important to be aware of the requirements that detectors for NDIRs need to fulfill. After that, I'll switch to products that are currently being developed by our team. I mean multi-channel detection modules for gas sensing. I will speak about options that are available for now and what are our plans for the future. So let's begin. Here you can see schematic cross-sections of a single and dual channel NDIR spectrophotometers. This type of sensors include components such as infrared source, mainly cheap thermal sources such as filament emitters, sample chambers, these are mainly tubes, reference chambers, optical filters, mostly narrow bandpass type, selective for strong absorption lines, infrared detectors, mostly pyroelectric or PBS or PBSE, signal processing electronics. The infrared light is directed through the sample chamber towards the detector. In parallel position to the sample chamber, there is another chamber with an enclosed reference gas. The gas is in the sample chamber, causes absorption of specific wavelengths, and the attenuation of these wavelengths is measured by the detector to determine the gas concentration. The optical filter, which may be mounted on infrared source or the detector, eliminates all light except the wavelength that the selected gas molecules can absorb. So, what are the main requirements for NDIRs? These are well-matched spectral response, selectively chosen for absorption lines of detected gas or gases. Also, stability under changing conditions. We expect stable parameters regardless the change of time, ambient pressure and temperature, electromagnetic, thermal, and mechanical interferences, etc. We also need to lower the noise level so the detectivity is high enough to lower the limit of detection. And our goal is to reach 1% of a lower explosive limit in the whole system. There are also any other specific requirements, for instance, linearity range, small size, low weight, specific field of view, low fringing, compatible frequency response, etc. It depends on specific application. And the last requirement is low cost of the final product. We plan to use as much automatization as possible to lower the cost and be prepared for the mass production. So, substitution of a pyroelectric detector for NDIRs. This is a little bit provocative of us to say we want to substitute a pyroelectric detector with a photodiode. It's not a substitution literally because of different principles of operation of these two types of detectors, but we would like to exchange the detector and in an NDIR system to make the parameters even better. It's quite easy with short and medium wavelength infrared detectors to have over one order of magnitude better detectivity performance than in the pyroelectric ones. The comparison is pyroelectric detectors have about 10 to the power of 8 detectivity, and our photodiodes will have over 10 to the power of 9. In long wavelength detectors, low resistance of uncooled devices makes coupling to low noise preamplifier difficult. And the matched preamplifiers exhibit significant 1 over F noise at a 10 Hz frequency. Also, the increase of the ambient temperature significantly reduces the responsivity and even more detectivity. The responsivity changes make highly reduce accuracy of measurements. And the first VIGO product I want to present you today is multiband 4EF5 detection module. The name is based on four elements with four filters, and the chips are optimized for 5 micrometers. We use 3TE cooler for gaining the temperature of 230 kelvins. And there are four channels with optical size of 1 square millimeter each. In this solution, we use four separate chips on carriers inside of a TO8 can. A big top stage of a cooler lets us to use four chips, each with the maximum edge size of 2 millimeters. So we present you today the solution that we've already worked on. But if you need some customization, just ask our sales team, and we will try to make a solution prepared just for you. This system is optimized for detection of most common gases, as you can see on the graphics. So it may be used for flame and fire detection, combustion process control, explosive detection, exhaust fumes analysis. Here you can see some parameters and overall dimensions. So as I said before, the detectivity is over 10 to the power of 9, and we will work on even better performance. We would also like to speak about our plans of development for dual channel detection module. On the right, you can see an exemplary figure of a TO39 monochannel detector. So, as you may have guessed, this iteration includes redesigning the detector package and miniaturize the whole system. We want to use the TO39 package with TE cooling. Also, we'll use ROHS compliant materials such as indium arsenium antimonide as a monolithic dual element structure, and redesigning the electronics just as a tailor-made part. We expect to create a solution with temperature drifts compensation and use as much automatization in this product process as possible. We look ahead to lower the costs of manufacturing and be prepared for mass production of this product, as I said before. As a preparation for this new product, currently we want to make the proof of concept based on available system. And this product consists of components from multiband for EF5 module, such as same TE cooler, same electronics with redesigned cap for two channels. Regarding the electronics, we will have leave the two channels inactive for this test. And this type of detector chip is made of two elements processed from the same wafer and assembled on silicon substrate. And detector will be optimized for propane detection. This solution will be available. We think it may be in the
soon.
Yes, soon, but the beginning of next year, we will have some tests, and you may be sure that we will inform you about our results. Okay, but multiband for EF5 is ready for your orders. Just contact our sales team or tech support. Maybe you may use some customized version. So we just have to talk about your needs. Thank you very much. And if you have any questions, please write it down on the chat.
Thank you, Karolina. That was pretty great presentation. Let's see if we got any questions during the chat. I'm sorry, unfortunately I was dropped from the Zoom meeting, so I will have to use here. Serge G, can see you. Okay, so if we receive the questions later, we'll answer them in the email. Thank you, Karolina. That was, I hope you see the overview of our new products. We didn't want to go really deep into application because we don't want to explain to you how to use your how to approach your applications. We just barely produce the tools for your success. But currently, let's switch to another topic, to Philip's presentation. Philip, are you with us?
I don't know if
I'll be able to tell anything more, so I'll just pass my voice to Philip and let's hear what's going on underneath the package, right? So Philip, let's go.
Okay, thanks. Okay, so I hope you can see the presentation. Hopefully. My name is Philip Wabai, as mentioned before, and today I'll be talking about mid-infrared spectroscopy, and more precisely, mid-infrared spectroscopy that we are approaching at VIGO. So a little bit about products, but of course we'll start with the basics. So the presentation is structured in the following way. We'll start with an introduction. I'll explain a little bit what is spectroscopy, if there is someone that doesn't know, of course, in the audience. I'll talk about spectroscopic methods in a very broad way, so dividing them perhaps in one way that they can be divided, so for detector site methods and source site methods. We'll make a little detour towards the sense of using mid-infrared. Why should we use mid-infrared instead of, for example, the visible spectrum? And then we'll get to the center of the presentation. So the ideas and the prototypes and the approaches that we have developed throughout the last year of work on spectrometers in VIGO. This will be finalized with a demonstrator of the current of our current well, not yet product, but of the system, of the device. And to finalize the whole presentation, we'll talk a little bit more about the most interesting matter, I think, in this, so the applications of spectroscopy, the sense of using spectroscopy and any kind of industrial applications and similar. So without further ado, let's start. Hopefully Sir Newton is watching over us on this journey. And let's start from the absolute basics. So one definition of spectroscopy could be shown as is written here on the slide. So those are the methods. This is the interaction of light with matter. However, the word light here might be a little bit confusing because perhaps some of you know that there are other types of spectroscopy. There is acoustic spectroscopy that also tries to examine matter, examine substances, but by using acoustic waves, and particle spectroscopy, which does the same thing, but using particles, alpha particles, for example. So the most, however, the most commonly used, well, spectroscopy is most commonly used for electromagnetic radiation, and we'll be talking about this today mainly. So essentially, you could divide the methods in the electromagnetic spectrum on the following. This is, of course, a very very coarse division, and there are multitude. There's a multitude of other methods. However, many of them based on the same principles. So the ways in which light can interact with matter. Three of those ways, because there are a few more, but the most important ones are absorption, emission, and excitation of the atoms of the substance we are measuring, essentially. Absorption and emission are fairly simple concepts, which base on the fact that electrons take position in atoms. They take positions in very specific places and very specific bands and energy bands, essentially. And to change position, they require a specific amount of energy, either to transit downwards, as is the case in emission, and then the energy is emitted, or to transit upwards, then you need to add some energy. Now, you need very specific energy, very specific amount of energy to change the position of an electron. And this corresponds directly with the wavelength of the light that you're using, because as you can see on this equation here, the wavelength of light is inversely related to the energy. Having a photon that has longer wavelength gives us less energy, and vice versa, of course. So having a photon that has a shorter wavelength gives us more energy in this photon. So essentially, by having an atom that has very well defined states of transition, one can check if certain wavelengths are absorbed or emitted from this substance, for example, from this atom. This is of course represented here as a dark line for absorption and bright line for emission, which I think is fairly straightforward. So we can use those phenomena, those three described phenomena, which I would like to add here, of course, not all the possible interactions of light with matter. We can use those phenomena to essentially measure a sample's absorption potential, you could say, or its emission potential, or its excitation potential, by essentially either transmitting the light through the sample, illuminating the sample and checking what it emits, or illuminating the sample with a constant wavelength and checking the spectrum that it emits. So a bit more technical, going to a bit more technical area. Now I'll describe the spectroscopy methods. Now, I have divided them, perhaps. Well, it's one way that you could divide those methods. Like I said, there are a multitude of those approaches that were developed throughout the last 200, 300 years. One way to divide them is to divide them onto methods that change the wavelength that we are measuring on the sample by changing the emission of the light source, or by changing the wavelength that falls onto the detector. So essentially detecting wavelengths after changing them in front of the detector, essentially. So let's start with the detector side. As you can see, quite a few methods. This slide is pretty intimidating, I'm sure, so I try to keep it as concise as possible. So in the left upper side, we have dispersive optical approaches. So essentially, we take some light that has some kind of spectrum. It could have already transferred through a sample, and the sample could have already imprinted its specific absorption lines onto the light. And then we diffract the light, for example, and check the diffraction pattern on a detector array. As you can see, the diffraction of the light produces a spectrum. So different wavelengths fall into different places, different spatial locations. The same case is here in transmission, using a transmission grating. We also get a diffraction spectrum. Now, another way to approach this is by using waveguide dispersion. I'll talk about this at the end because this is a pretty interesting subject. And well, I'll just expand upon it a little bit. Now, a second way to do this, so essentially to check what kind of wavelengths we get after the sample, is to use narrowband filters. We can use filters that are tunable in time. So essentially, every time step we get a different wavelength onto a detector. So the detector just has to be able to see all the whole range of wavelengths. And we choose which wavelengths are transmitted. Or we can use a filter array. For example, we could use constant filters. This is very similar to what Karolina was talking about non-dispersive infrared filters, where we filter essentially the light in spatially separated places. So the detector array is illuminated with different wavelengths in each place. Or we could use a variable filter, for example, a filter with two mirrors and a resonator. Here, spatially separated. Here they were, temporally separated, and here they are spatially separated. Now, another approach that goes at the subject from a bit different way is the Fourier transform methods. So we essentially once again take the light that has some kind of spectrum that we want to measure, and we input it into an interferometer system. For example, a Michelson interferometer. Here we have one moving mirror, which changes the optical path difference between those two arms. And in effect, we get interference patterns on the detector. By measuring those patterns and applying inverse Fourier transform, we can easily access the spectral information. And this can be done also in different ways. For example, in a Mach-Zehnder interferometer. As you can see, this approach here uses waveguides. So we essentially change the parameters of the waveguide, for example, by heating it up, we could also use MEMS mirrors here to change the path. In any case, we get once again an interference pattern on the output. We can structure those Mach-Zehnder interferometers into an array to have different spectral ranges. And yeah, those are fairly interesting methods. Now, the last part that I would like to talk about here are the reconstructive spectroscopic methods. So those are perhaps the most exotic ones. We use, for example, an array of filters that each of which has a different spectral characteristic. So each of them transmits a different portion of the spectrum in a specific way. If we calibrate all those filters, so if we measure them for a stable source, for example, approximately flat bandwidth source, we could get those responses, and by knowing those responses, we can then reconstruct any kind of spectrum that falls onto this device already, let's say in the field. This is a method that uses essentially uses numerical approaches to reconstruct the spectrum. So it's not a straightforward measurement of the spectrum like this. It was the case in all those three divisions, let's say, but we approach this a bit more numerically. Okay, so those were the methods that that use some kind of modulation, wavelength modulation, separation on the detector side, but we can also change the way the light or light source emits light. So, for example, if we use a laser, we could try to tune its gain, we could try to tune the losses in the laser resonator cavity, or we could try to tune the resonant frequency. So, for example, changing the length of the resonator. This, in effect, would give us different wavelengths on the output of the laser. If we have different wavelengths, then we can easily scan over each wavelength and see how the how the sample reacts to each wavelength, if it absorbs or not, or any kind of measurement, really. Another approach, those are, of course, only chosen examples. There's a multitude of ways to modulate a light source and to change its emitted wavelength. One example here, pretty interesting, I think, is using a nonlinear acousto-optic modulator. So essentially, by modulating it with acoustic waves, we can get different wavelengths in a pretty broad spectrum, as you can see here, from 2.9 to 3.3 micrometers. Each of these peaks is fairly nicely defined, as you can see here, and we can measure the sample with a high degree of confidence. So those were the methods for spectroscopy that we talked about just a moment before, without really talking about which wavelengths with spectral regions to use. Now, of course, in this presentation we try to focus on mid-infrared radiation, but why? Why should we use mid-infrared radiation? So the usual reason for this is pretty simple. This is a region in which several gases, several substances, exhibit very high absorption, and absorption in fairly nicely defined wavelength regions. So essentially, we can measure. We can get a good amount of information by measuring them in this region. And moreover, we can detect types of materials by having, for example, multiple peaks. We can compare them to some kind of spectra from a database, for example, and check what we are seeing. So what we are detecting essentially in our system. A little side note, perhaps there are multiple definitions of what mid-infrared is. Some sources state that this is any wavelength from 3 micrometers to 20, 25 micrometers. Others state that this is anything from 2 micrometers to 8 micrometers. Now, we mostly operate in this presentation, we'll mostly operate in the region of 2.8 to 5 micrometers, more or less. Another perhaps interesting side note here: why do those substances exhibit such high absorption? As it happens, when we use wavelengths from the mid-infrared region, and as we remember from the beginning of the presentation, when light has a certain wavelength, it carries a certain amount of energy with it. As it happens, light in the mid-infrared region carries just enough energy to influence the vibrational modes of compounds, of chemical compounds. In effect, the light can be heavily absorbed by those compounds, and moreover, those compounds exhibit specific absorption. So they have a specific absorption spectra that we can use to our advantage by using light from this region. Okay, so that was the theory. So let's see how we try to approach this this issue of designing a miniaturized spectrometer in practice. We started with a fairly classical, fairly old design that is called the Cherny-Turner spectroscope or monochromator, even optical system, in which we used a fairly broad spectral source that emitted light in a cone. The light was then reflected, cut out by a input slit, and collimated into a collimated beam, into which we could insert our sample that we have measured, and then the collimated beam fell onto a flat diffraction grating, which diffracted the light, of course, and in turn created a spectrum of light in our detector plane. In this example, we have used a single element detector. By using a single element detector, we had to approach this problem also fairly classically. So we had to provide a mechanical system to scan over the wavelengths. As you can see, here we motorized the grating. I can go back for a second here. So we essentially tried to turn the grating with a defined angle. And by turning the grating, we can scan the spectrum over the detector, and in turn, see which wavelengths have which intensity. The whole system design was fairly simple. So we used a linear motor, which for each step of its movement gave us a very, very small change in angle. We could control this linear stage from a computer, for example. So we gave a move order to the controller, the stage moved. The linear movement was converted to rotational movement by using this very, very simple, let's call it a simple joint. The rotational movement then influenced the spectrum in the detector plane, and the signal from the detector was amplified and then measured and returned to the computer, which allowed us to create a spectrum. However, this approach was wasn't very miniaturized, and it wasn't very it isn't very reliable, because we have to add a motorized stage, and this in turn requires all the drivers and a lot more energy. So a second idea that we had was to use concave holographic gratings. So those are essentially gratings that whose structure is created in a concave substrate. In this case, those are reflective gratings. So by inputting the light into the system, we can not only disperse the wavelengths in a certain plane, but we can also focus them in a certain plane, which miniaturizes the system and greatly simplifies it. And here we use only one reflective element as compared to those three mirrors beforehand. So by using an input slit or the tip of a optical fiber, we can shine the light essentially into the system, disperse it. And we in this design we made use of the Rowland circle. This is a phenomena, perhaps you could call it a phenomena, in which by having an input slit on the outer rim of a circle and having the grating on the other side, we can get an aberration-free image in the plane. Now, the only aberration really that could have been could have appeared in the system then was the fact that we didn't have a concave detector but a flap detector. So there would be the issue of simply defocusing on the rims of the detector. We measured and simulated this design. As you can see here, we also tried to simulate the optical window of the detector array. Once again, the light comes in, is dispersed, goes through the window, and falls onto a detector. So for a detector that would have infinitely small pixels and that would have, essentially, a perfect detection plane, the theoretical resolution of this device was 28 nanometers. Now, by resolution here, I mean the size of the smallest detail that we can resolve, that we can see essentially with the device. As you can see, the spectrum is fairly nicely distributed in the range of 3.4 to 4 micrometers. Another approach to this design was to use a different concave grating, a more approachable grating that had stock parameters, and simply shortening the whole, decreasing the whole volume by using two mirrors. The optical path length remains unchanged, but we compress essentially the whole system. As you can see, once again, we get a nice dispersion in the detection plane. And once again, for a perfect detector plane, we would have 30 nanometers of resolution. OK, so this was another approach. But as it appeared, those gratings aren't really simple to manufacture. And moreover, they're pretty expensive. So another idea was to use variable linear space gratings, VLS for short. Now, those gratings are an interesting device, because as compared to classical gratings that have a constant period of change, so essentially the, you could call it, notches in the grating, the distance between them remains constant throughout the whole length of the grating. In this case, we have a variable distance between the notches. So yeah, as you can see, they get more and more compressed in one direction. And this, in turn, allows us to use the gratings not only for dispersion, not only for analyzing the light, but also for focusing the light on a plane. As you can see here, the whole system was fairly small. and fairly simple to manufacture as well. We use an aperture in front that consists essentially of a small area that has a deposited mirror surface on it. The light is reflected and falls onto the first grating. The first grating disperses the light. As you can see here, there is another reflection on the second mirror. The second mirror reroutes the light onto the second grating, and the second grating focuses the light onto our detector array. So we also simulated this approach. As you can see here, we get a fairly nicely defined spectrum on the detector array. Once again, with the inclusion of a window, of a detector array window. However, as you can see, also the resolution is falling onto the sides, so we get good focus in the front. Not in the front, in the middle of the detector array, but on the sides it gets a bit worse. So once again, the theoretical resolution in this kind of device in the simulations was 94 nanometers, so a bit worse than the previous designs, in a spectral range of 3 to 4 micrometers, so a bit better spectral range. However, the whole system could be nicely fitted into a very, very small package. So what we essentially need in such a package is the input module, and here this would be the fiber optic port mounted into the mechanical system. This would reroute the light into the spectrum module, which then would reroute the diffracted light, the dispersed light, onto the detector array, and then amplification detection and some kind of output. As you can see here, the pins are on the side. So this whole package was fairly small, like I said. The total volume that we have achieved in the theoretical and the CAD models was around 55 cubic centimeters, so it easily fits into the palm of a hand. And as you can see, the standardized fiber port also allows for easy usage. Moreover, the detector can be taken out of this case and exchanged for perhaps a detector of a different wavelength, of a different spectral response. Okay, so this was another approach. However, once again, it appeared that the fabrication of those gratings was fairly complex and required very high precision, so it wasn't very economically viable. Now, another approach that we have found and that we have undertaken was to use linear variable optical filters and linear variable filters. So LVOFs, for short, are a type of filter that uses two mirrors, one of which is tilted, and essentially this creates a resonator between those mirrors. A resonator, in this case, will separate the wavelengths spatially once again. So each detector after such a filter will be seeing another set of wavelengths, as you can see here. An example spectrum of such a device is shown here. As you can see, the peaks overlap on each other, which is, of course, this is, of course, an effect of the tilt. So we have a constant tilt throughout the whole device. Essentially, nonetheless, we have fairly well-defined peaks on the other side of such a filter. Now, the other way to approach this issue is to use filters, but filters that don't have a tilted mirror, but instead they have a thin layer deposited on top of it. And this true interference also creates the same effect. So essentially, having broadband light shined onto it, we get different wavelengths on the other side of the filter. As you can see, this is a product of vertical optical coatings, and it achieves a fairly nice narrow spectral width. One mention before we go further. As you can see, the full width half maximum, so essentially the width, how many wavelengths on the sides of the center wavelength that we're interested in are transmitted, it changes with the change of the wavelength. So for a filter that starts at 2.5 micrometers, we can reach 50 nanometers. However, at the end of this filter, for 5 micrometers for light that shines for light that has 5 micrometers of wavelength, we can only reach 80 nanometers. Now, this is of course a drawback in this kind of filters. So using those filters, we once again designed an optical system. We used a input slit or a fiber optic port. Either way, the light, which was an approximation of a spherical beam, fell onto the off-axis parabolic mirror. The off-axis parabolic mirror collimated the beam, and the collimated beam transmitted through the filter and fell onto the detector array. So an interesting issue here was how to mount those filters. One approach was, of course, to put those filters on top of a flat pack package and simply glue them. Of course, if you would want to hermetize this device, you'd have to use wider filters to cover the whole hole, or you know, use a different hole for the filter. Nonetheless, as you can see, this is a fairly easy approach. However, this also creates a distance between the detector array and the filter itself. So if you would use not well collimated light, this might be a problem of crosstalk between the pixels in this array. Another approach that we thought about was to simply mount the filter on top of the array. So we would use glue or any other kind of bonding to put the filter directly onto the pixels. However, for simulation purposes and for further demonstration purposes, we use the first approach, as it was just simply simpler to us. We also simulated this system, as you can see here, with a very non-collimated light beam after the off-axis parabolic mirror. As you can see, we try to check how the light intensity would be detected by the array. One interesting problem, perhaps, in the system was the possible influence of fringing on our signal. So by having so many, go back for a little bit, by having so many flat layers, so many parallel layers to each other, we could introduce the effect of fringing. So essentially the interference of light that bounced off and off again from each of the surfaces. We tried to simulate this, and as you can see, we succeeded, of course, in the simulation. Nonetheless, as you can see, fringing is very wavelength dependent. So for wavelengths that are longer, we get a lower period of those fringes. Nonetheless, in the final system, we do not have the spectral resolution to see those fringes. So this would only result in a decrease of intensity, most likely. Okay, so that was the final approach, and this is the approach that we used in our demonstrator. So the demonstrator presents itself in the following way. As you can see, we use a standard fiber port that is connected on a Torlabs collimator in this example. This is connected to a mechanical interface, and this in turn is connected to a 32-element module with all the electronics already connected to it as well. So in cross-section, this looks like this. The beam emitted from the fiber that is mounted into the port is collimated, as was shown before in the optical system. The light goes through a series of apertures and falls onto the filter. There it is filtered and falls onto the detector array. The detector array is mounted on in this case, 3 stages of thermoelectric cooling, and the electronics, as you can see here, are easily accessible. Each of the channels is easily accessible. Further electronics for the cooler control and signal processing are mounted here. So essentially the same thing. So a few words about the way the detector is structured. We have 32 pixels currently. However, we can also extend that to any other amount of pixels, up to 128, for example. Nonetheless, in this approach, we have 32 pixels, each of which has a length of 125 micrometers and a width of 1,000 micrometers. Each pixel is separated from the next one by 25 micrometers, essentially a valley. Now, this might seem a bit unusual that we use pixels that don't have the same lengths on their sides. However, this is used for purposes of increasing the possible signal-to-noise ratio. So by having a larger surface to a certain amount of surface, of course, we can detect more light and in turn get a better signal. This is why this was used in such a way. The filters simply fit over the whole array. So pixels in this array have the following simulated characteristics. As you can see, we have a fairly linear response in the range that is interesting to us. So this would be 3 to 4 micrometers. And the detectivity of those pixels is on the following scale. And finally, the whole system, as you can see here, has the following parameters. So also the following features, starting with those perhaps. So as I have said before, in this version, we think about having a SMA fiber input port with an optional mechanical slit input port. So this is easily exchangeable. A 32-channel analog output, which could also be exchanged for a digital USB output. And yes, the whole device operates in a range of 3 to 4 micrometers with a spectral resolution of 60 to 80 nanometers. So once again, using those filters, we are dependent on the wavelength. So for the longer wavelengths, we get a lower resolution. But this is the drawback of those filters, essentially. The number of pixels is 32. The numerical aperture is given here for the fiber port. The dimensions of the device are the following, and this gives us a volume of 195 cubic centimeters. This is a bit larger than the version that used the variable linear gratings. Nonetheless, we still kind of fit into a palm of a hand. The mass of this device would be around 160 grams. So, simulating all the optical losses in the system, we essentially in a demonstrator setup, we get 0.1 milliwatts of optical power that falls onto each pixel, and this is for one watt in input of the demonstrator. So for a pixel area of the following, and for a normalized bandwidth of the detector, normalized 1 hertz, we get a noise equivalent power of 2.24 times 10 to the minus 9 watts. This in turn gives us a single signal to noise ratio of 800. So this is a SNR that is calculated without the influence of a measured substance. In a demonstrator setup with a measured substance that is in the optical path, we would, of course, get a lower SNR, but still kind of approximately in the range of 400 to 800. So this is an example demonstrator setup in which we use a broadband light source, which emits light afterwards collimated. The collimated light passes through an optical chopper. This is perhaps an important part of this, but we do not feature, not yet, in any case, we do not yet feature any kind of modulation, signal modulation devices on the spectrometer. So you essentially, in this kind of demonstrator setup, one has to use a optical chopper, for example, to modulate the light, to modulate the signal that you get on the output. The light, after being chopped, modulated, goes into a fiber coupler, goes into a mid-infrared fiber, and then transmitting through this kind of cuvette, in which you can measure any kind of liquid solid samples, is then transmitted once again into a fiber and into our spectrometer. A few more photos from different sites, as you can see here. Okay, so this was our device. Now let's talk about the possible application of mid-infrared spectrometers, more precisely. Why should you bother with using one of those? So one obvious application is, of course, measuring the samples in this region. Essentially, once again, by using, for example, an absorption setup and emitting light. This would be, here we have shown a frequency comp. This could be any kind of source, any kind of broadband light source. The light passes through the sample, gets some kind of spectrum imprinted, let's say, on it, and in turn gets onto into a spectrometer where it is analyzed. So an example of a high resolution absorption spectrum, not ours, not yet in any case, because we do not yet achieve that kind of resolution, but just to show how it could look like, is the following. This is the absorption spectrum of ethanol in the infrared spectrum. As you can see here, this is a range from 2 to 12 approximately micrometers. A working spectrum would fall then into this area, so the 3 to 4 micrometers. As you can see here, ethanol has a pretty well-defined double-funked peak, absorption peak in this region. So having the right resolution, towards which we are trying to go, could allow us to detect essentially the type of substance or and its concentration measurement based on the amount of absorption. So this was a classical approach, however, a standard approach to spectrometry, to the usage of spectrometry. Nonetheless, a fairly interesting different approach is to use spectrometry for multi and hyperspectral imaging. So essentially, you could simply call it take a picture of a scene of something. Here, for example, we have a satellite picture. And not only do we have the intensity of light in each pixel, but we also have the spectrum of the light that was falling onto each pixel. This can be done in several ways. The easiest one would be, of course, easiest one from the user side, of course, not the designer side, would be to use snapshot imaging. So just take one picture, and you have the whole information. So each pixel has the spectral information in it. This would, however, require that we have a spectrometer in front of each pixel, which is doable, of course, but from an infrared, it's not quite so straightforward. So another approach would be to try spatial scanning. Essentially, you have a spectrometer and you scan throughout the image and create a hyperspectral image, a hyperspectral cube, as it is called. One could also scan spectrally. So essentially, you have the image and you acquire the image in different wavelengths. And of course, any kind of hybrid combination of those two. And so scanning strategies could be some scanning strategies are shown here on the slide. One of those, the oldest one, I think, and commonly used in the last century in various military applications, is the so-called whisk broom scanner. So we have essentially one pixel, and we scan this pixel line after line after line to create the whole two-dimensional hyperspectral image. Now, another way to do this is to use a detector array, for example, this kind of detector array that we are also using in our spectrometer, and to get to scan the scene, the image, line by line. Straightforward. In hyperspectral imaging is to have several arrays side by side and to acquire the image progressively. So each array scans over and over the same region, and in the end we can get an image that has a better signal-to-noise ratio than an image that only scans, you know, snapshot imaging with those arrays. So potential uses of such devices that can image hyperspectrally could be, for example, sorting. Now, this approach uses a detector array. So essentially, we image a line, we check the spectrum of the material that we have, and then we sort it. As you can see, plastics have fairly nicely defined transmittance, and in turn, of course, absorbance in the mid-infrared and long-wave infrared region. We could, of course, also image this in 2D. So we would also have as I talked before, the whole spatial information, not only the spectral information, which would be useful, for example, in any kind of sorting applications that require to, that either have a high throughput or that require manual or, you know, robotic arm separation of the materials. Now, a perhaps more interesting approach to use hyperspectral imaging is to image a scene, and of course we get the information about spectrum in each pixel of the scene, and by using this information we can determine where, for example, hazardous substances could be found. So, for example, here we have TNT on the door handle of this SUV. As you can see, the whole scene was scanned, and the spectrum was acquired. And based on the spectrum, we have the material was identified in this image. So not only do we have the information about the type of material, but we also have the information about the location of this material. This is, of course, also useful in the dynamically developing field of precision agriculture. So for example, we could mount a spectrometer, a scanning spectrometer, for example, if we would use a line array, onto a drone, fly the drone over an area with fields, with crops. And by using the spectral information, we could identify if plants are stressed, if plants have enough water, and so on and so on. Now, by using the spatial information, we can in turn determine where those plants are and where do we have to, for example, take steps to add more water to those plants, for example. This is, of course, very easily integratable into a whole automated farm system, for example. So it's a pretty exciting prospect of an application. Another way to use spectral imaging and essentially acquiring spectral information in space and in with the spatial part is to determine the location of gas leaks. So as I have talked before, the several gases, several substances exhibit high absorption in the mid-infrared region. So essentially by shining light, for example, through a volume of free space, we could check if the light was absorbed, and if it was absorbed, then we can check on which wavelengths it was absorbed. And if we know that, we can try to identify the substance and its concentration. Now, if we would add to this scanning over the area, we could identify, for example, the shape of the gas cloud, we could identify the location of the gas cloud, which is, of course, much more important. It doesn't only tell us that there is a leak, but it also tells us where the leak is. Yes, so those were the potential applications and, well, current applications of those systems. However, I'd like to talk a little bit more about the demonstrator. So what are the next steps in its development? So currently we will be building this device and try and build a demonstration system that we can hopefully show to you and get some feedback on its state. And then we'll try to further improve the system. We see a few fields that we could change, we could exchange for better parts. So, for example, we could change the filters that we use inside the device for better filters that have a better transmission, that have a narrower wavelength transmission. This would in turn give us a better resolution if we decrease the size of the full width at half maximum of the transmitted peaks. Adding more pixels, we could get an even better resolution. And essentially, this is the direction that we would like to go with this device. We theorize that we could achieve a resolution of even 25 nanometers in a device that wouldn't be much different from this one. Moreover, we are currently working on miniaturizing the electronic assembly. So essentially, this whole green area here will be fitted into a flat pack case. As you have seen before, the flat pack is not a lot smaller than the whole electronic assembly here. So we could highly decrease the footprint of the whole device. With this combined with a reduction of the collimator, which would most likely be redesigned. So it wouldn't be bought from Tolabs anymore, but would be redesigned to a more custom design version. We could get the footprint down to below 100 cubic centimeters, which I think is pretty exciting for a device of this type. Okay, so those are the plans for the device. Now, those are a bit more theoretic plans, and we are nearing towards the end of the presentation, so I'll try to keep it as short as possible. We haven't yet talked about the waveguide dispersion methods. So those are based essentially on the fact that light, when propagating to a specific medium, to a specifically chosen medium, engineered medium, for example, light, certain wavelengths are, well, let's say, promoted. So essentially what we get is that is a dispersed spectrum after such a propagation. As you can see, the lengths of those paths are, of those waveguides, are different in length. So for an input spectrum of this kind, we could also easily measure it in such a way. Here it's shown in a quantized form. Now those waveguides are pretty easy to integrate, as is written here, into photonic integrated circuits. You can essentially fabricate them in a 2D form and package them and have a very small device. Another approach is to use Fourier transform infrared methods. Those are the most usually the most precise methods, and they're usually used exactly in applications where precision is required. So a interesting approach to those systems is to miniaturize them into MEMS systems. Well, using MEMS systems into very small packages, essentially 2D planar optical systems. As you can see here, using a MEMS mirror, we try to try to emulate the movement that was shown to get a interference pattern in time on the output light. Another approach to this is to use a maximum interferometer that is also planary created, fabricated. As you can see here, once again, we use a very small, waveguide-based system in which we can modulate the arms. So here, for example, this is simply done as the arm is exposed to the outer world, essentially. And this is, of course, also transferable to waveguide arrays, as is shown here, on a very small footprint. Those kinds of systems are usually can be used in, for example, integrated microfluidics, where we take where we use very small volumes of chemicals, for example, and we create, we perform chemical reactions, and we want to be able to monitor them. So using such a spectrometer that is mounted somewhere inside this kind of device, we can monitor the processes in real time, and all of this could fit onto a chip. Okay, so the last thing I want to talk about is the reconstructive approach to acquiring a spectrum. This is an approach that we are trying currently to implement because we are using very few pixels, and what we are using with the LVF filter is essentially very similar to what is shown here. So once again, having a unique spectral response for each of the channels, optimally this would be an orthogonal spectral response for each of those channels so that we don't have any redundant information transmitted. Spectral information transmitted. Once again, calibration could allow us to achieve to get a reconstructed spectrum, that could have a better resolution than in the case of just simply transmitting light and dispersing it using a standard filter. So essentially a very very numerical method, could say. Okay, and this was the last slide, so thank you for your attention. I hope it wasn't too boring, and I'm open to any questions that you could have.
Thank you, Philippe. Sorry, my reaction was a little bit late. I don't know if we have much more to say. I see no questions, so probably everybody needs to digest all the presentation. I highly recommend to watch it again on YouTube or on LinkedIn on our profile. It's a lot of data, a lot of ideas. We are ready to discuss them all. So... I hope it wasn't too much in such a short time, but we tried to be as accurate as possible. So thank you everybody for your time, and let's see each other in email. Sorry, unfortunately, Carolina. Thanks for the presentation. Do we have a Mach Zehnder interferometer for mid IR in the mid IR?
I can try to answer. So we are not yet developing such planar devices in the mid IR. Nonetheless, this is on the way in VIGO. So we'll be essentially also approaching these types of devices. Not specifically the Mach Zehnder interferometer structure, but similar integrated photonic circuits?
I think it's a good question for an email, so we can elaborate maybe a little bit wider on this. So, Philip, thanks. That was pretty amazing that you keep up with this amount of data. Everybody, thank you for your time. See you on the next webinar. And I hope you enjoyed our new approach for developing VIGO products. So thank you very much once again. Just a reminder to be updated with our LinkedIn. That's always where we put the newest data and newest information all about VIGO. So have a great one and see you soon. Bye-bye.